This is the K95.3 Sports Show Podcast, brought to you by The Fan Zone in Wilmer's Candy Mall.
Welcome to the K95.3 Sports Show Podcast. My name is Bo Stamfis. I am your host. As usual, if you like what you hear, please hit the thumbs up, hit the subscribe button, hit the bell next to the subscribe button, and you'll get push notifications every week on your phone when a new episode comes out. Thank you to the Fan Zone for sponsoring the sports show. We appreciate them doing that. Please get into the Candy Mall and check out their store today. New also for us is I am on Twitter now. I started the K95.3 Sports Show Podcast on Twitter. So make sure you check that out. It's just at K95.3 Sports Show. There I'll be talking throughout the week. I've been busy over the last week and a half that I've been doing it. Talking, posting things, watching the game, giving in-game analysis and stuff like that on my Twitter. So make sure to follow me on Twitter for that. Also coming up later in the episode here is the Stinger Spotlight. That will be with Cal Elvers from the University of Miami, Ohio. So make sure you check that out coming up here. But first, we'll get into the Twins. Here with me are my guests is Tim Meyering. How are you doing, Tim?
Doing great. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, man. Long time.
Yeah, no kidding. What the heck?
And then I brought Jeremy Hazen back. Jeremy, how's it going?
Oh, it's great.
Awesome. Thanks, guys, for coming in and helping me out this week. Let's talk about the Twins a little bit here for the last week or so. Obviously, they just got back from a 10-game road trip starting tonight, Tuesday night, back home. And they went 6-4 on the road trip.
Right. You know, it's pretty sad, guys. I know we're going to talk about this. But did you guys also think we weren't playing too great the last 2 weeks? Like, thinking, like, man, we're not playing that great ball. We lost four games, and we lost 4 out of 10 games. It's like, We're playing pretty good
ball.
It's
just 600 ball.
Yeah, we're so spoiled. It's like,
You play that the rest of the season, you're still, like, guaranteed in the wild card.
Yeah, well, yeah, division, basically, yeah. I just think it's kind of funny how we win 6 out of 10 games, and at least I was like, oh, man, that's not too great. But it's like, that's how spoiled we've been this year. Isn't that sad? So, I mean, I'm pretty
sad
happy with it.
Sad or awesome.
Yeah, yes. Well, yeah, right.
Yeah, no, it's, you know, like I said, it was you know, obviously it was disappointing in Cleveland splitting that series
right
with them. You know, there's a little bit of a pitching flubs there here and there, and that's going to happen throughout the season. You know, losing one to Detroit, not the end of the world. We're not going to sweep them every time. You know, they are division rival. And, you know, just in any sport, division rivals, when they play against each other, you know, throw out the records.
Right.
Because
it does not matter. It's how it's always been with us, too. So, I mean, and Detroit's always put us pretty tough.
And, you know, last time I was in here, we talked about that Milwaukee and Tampa series. So, Tampa being included in this road trip, you know, we were talking about hoping that they would split. Well, they won 3 out of 4. So really, you are disappointed that you lost 2 out of 3 against Cleveland. But I mean, swap that for one of those wins against Tampa. You know, let's say we split that Tampa series like we were talking about, and then you go on to win 2 out of 3. You're still 6-4.
Yeah, that's
10,
a good point.
So.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. No. Like I said, overall, a successful road trip. Obviously, anytime you're over 500 on a road trip that long, it's a successful road trip. So it was definitely an overall positive thing for them on that. You know, I'm sure we'll bounce back and forth with some more stuff on there, but you know, I did want to, I added into the itinerary. I didn't give it to you guys, but I've totally forgot to put an Astudillo being sent down. And that, I mean, that I, to plug my Twitter, I called it. I called it during the game, the night that he got sent down. I was like, it's time for Astudillo to be sent down.
Wow, Bo.
I wanted...
what a great MLB mind.
I know, right? Jeez. I didn't even know I had this great...
Man.
Just plug in the front office there.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't expect a relief pitcher to come in. I was saying to bring up Arias.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And to have him come back up. But maybe he'll eventually come up anyways. But yeah, Astudillo was batting like 200 over the last month.
He was not playing well at all, and like
base running gas.
Yeah, yeah, and then like and people are like, oh, he never strikes out. It's like, yeah, but he puts the ball in play and he hits swings at the first pitch every time. He's swinging in his shoe out of his shoes. It's like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, he never strikes out, but he also never walks. Yeah, it's kind of a catch 22 there.
Yeah,
and I agree. A good call on that one. I didn't expect him to go this soon, but it really was time for him to go down. I mean, give me a break.
Well, and when you get Garver back and he comes back and he's immediately swinging the bat.
Already raking, yeah.
You know, you just can't justify carrying three catchers. So I think it's a good move. Get an extra arm, especially.
And when he was hitting 300, that justified having a third catcher.
And the fact that he can play other positions and give other guys a break. But with everyone top to bottom through the lineup hitting, you don't want to sit any of those other guys. Yep. So he would just be sitting on the bench here.
And now healthy.
Mm-hmm, and everyone healthy, yeah, for sure.
And Adrianza, if he had not been like, he's been killing the ball the last month, right? And like, was he like, at one point he was 9 for his last 11 or something like that. Mm-hmm. And trust me, he would have gone down. Like, I mean, or he would have gotten cut. He doesn't have any options left. He would have gotten cut and Astley would have stayed up. But with how good he's been playing for his job, right? I mean, don't you think? I mean, so Astudillo's just lack of getting on base and lack of, like Bo said, that some of those base running gaps. Like, what is he doing on a couple of those plays? Are you kidding me? So, and he had options. So,
yeah, and he's first or second on the depth chart for coming up.
Oh, he'll be back up right away.
Yeah, I'm sure. So I have a feeling that's the way it's going to be. Is as long as we're healthy, he's probably going to be down. But once one or two people, if somebody goes down, then we'll bring him up. But yeah, no, it's too bad. It is, but it is, but. We, like you said, we got two great catchers, so why? No reason to sleep over it and lose sleep over it. So we'll see him again. So,
and not just two catchers, but two catchers who are hitting well.
Yeah,
and playing great defense. You know, it's something that it just had to happen.
Yep. No, I agree. Well, let's jump on here. When we were talking last week, Dan and I, for just a few minutes, we talked Kimbrel. Then the next day, he signed with the Cubs.
Mm-hmm.
I know from what I read, basically, it was that we offered him 2 years and he wanted three. And Cubs were one of them that gave him three.
Right.
And or maybe we offered him three, but it was a club option.
I think that's what they were saying, is because someone asked Dave St. Peter about what the whole deal that happened. And he kind of reiterated that we didn't want to, like, it was an option. But at the same time, I don't understand why Craig Kimbrel would want to go to. And I get it. The Cubs are a good team, but you don't want to go pitch in Wrigley Field. I mean, at least I don't think you would. I mean, that stadium's just a little – it's tiny. Yep. Like, I always say that. You look at the pitcher's ERAs compared to everyone else in the league, and I know it's the National League. It's a pitcher's league. But, man, the Cubs, I really did not expect that at all. I did not expect it. But
yeah. Jeremy, what was your thoughts on them picking the Cubs?
You know, I can't really blame him. It's a major market. You know, he's able to market himself a little bit better there. He's going to be on national TV probably a little bit more.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they're going to be competitive. It's not a bad move from his standpoint. It just, you know, that kills us. We need some arms in the bullpen, you know.
And see, that's like I understand, too, the bigger market with Chicago and selling more jerseys and blah, 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 blah. Oh, yeah. But I mean, if he would have came up here... I feel like Chicagoans, I don't know.
Chicagoans.
that they would take him more for granted than we would up here.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. If he came up here and he was all of a sudden a key part for either a long playoff run or World Series title.
Championship title, yeah.
Yeah.
He
would be held up on a pedestal where I think he in there would just be more one of the guys in the mix.
Yep. Right. Yes.
I don't know 100%. If he thought of that. That was my thought process. I don't know why I'm being selfish and he should have picked us.
Right.
But whatever. It's gone. It's done. Unfortunately, we missed him, but we still have the bullpen issues. So what is next? You know, I think obviously is the trade deadline.
There are some big pieces out there. I mean, Ken Giles for the Blue Jays. He's had a really good year so far. Shane Green for the Tigers. I don't see us trading him for him because it's going to take a lot to get him.
He's and, the, like and in division too. So
yeah, they're not. Yeah, but you
know, I've always been like that. Don't trade inside the division unless you know you're screwing the other.
But
team
the Tigers
over.
Make some dumb trades. Yeah, sometimes too. And then a couple other guys. Yeah. Jake Diekman from the Royals has been great, but once again, in division. And then Sean Kelly, Will Smith for the Giants has a 10 for 10 saves, 0.89 whip, 185 opponents average. So there's guys out there. I mean, they're left, whether they're lefties or righties, there's guys out there still. People are like, oh, we missed on Kemble, we're screwed. No, there's been some pretty dang good relievers out there.
Yeah, I think they'll definitely go after one or even two.
Oh, yeah. A lot of these outlets are saying we might go after two guys, which that would be great. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you've got to bolster that bullpen. That's really our biggest hole right now. You know, the starting lineup is, you know, the starters are serviceable. You know, obviously there's a couple high end, but ultimately when you get to the playoffs, you shorten the rotation anyway. As long as we have those high end guys performing, I'm not so worried about the starting rotation. Let's bolster that bullpen and let's get some arms there, especially some lefties. You know, we've got what Rogers.
That's it.
Cool.
Yeah, right. And he's been good, but he's gotten roughed up a couple times, hasn't he?
It's tough having only the one lefty though. Like regardless of how he's performing, that's the only guy that you can rely on as a lefty option.
And trust me, every batter in the opposing team knows that lefty relief pitching scouting report. Like they know that, like that's one guy they're gonna bring in. They're gonna study that guy like crazy, you know. So
I think it's just consistency as a whole that we need on the relief pitching, because I mean over the last week Matt McGill is the one who crapped the bed each week. Each week when I sit down and kind of look, I see which one's crapped the bed the most. He did the most. Blake Parker has just been horrible this month. Yeah. I have him in fantasy, and if I didn't need his occasional save, I would have dropped him a long time ago. It's just aggravating. So, but the rest of the bullpen, Morin, 3 over last week, 0 by that Eds.
Ryan Eads.
Eads, yeah. Okay. Tyler Duffy, 2.25. Trevor Mays, 0. Taylor Rogers, 4.5. Ryan Harper, who's been great. I mean, wasn't he the guy who's like 30?
Yeah, call me crazy, but I think he should be closing for us. I might be dumb thing to say, but Harper's been pretty good. I mean, he's got that like 64 mile per hour curveball. It's like I just love watching that. But
25 innings pitched, 26 strikeouts. 0.94 whip, 1.75 ERA. He does have one save.
He just walks too many guys is what the problem is, isn't it?
No. His last 6 appearances I'm showing on here, he didn't walk a single person.
Never mind. I always liked him. He never walked anyone. He was awesome. I was thinking of the wrong guy or something. I'm not sure.
But, you know, see, that's the thing. Like I said, it's consistency on their side. I feel that's the problem is the consistency. They can have good weeks. But, you know, overall, they need just the more consistent aspect of it. You know, I mean, even take a look here over the last month, what they're kind of looking at. Matt McGill, 9 ERA over the last month.
Yeah, he was so good, too. And, like, late April, early May, wasn't he like one of our best relievers? He came back from injury, remember? And he was, like, lights out his, like, first 9 or 10 appearances, and now he's been kind of...
And Tyler Duffy's been overall solid. He's got a 2.55 ERA and 17 innings of pitch. So, I mean, like I said, I think we've got the guys. It's just we just have those couple.
Right.
That when they walk in.
You throw a couple more guys in the mix. And
exactly. And,
you know, it's going to be one of those things where we can actually be competitive in the postseason.
Yeah, I agree. But well, that'll be a continuing change throughout the season, and we'll talk more, I'm sure, about it throughout. Let's go ahead and touch on some of the hitting here. Nelson Cruz, he's back.
Man. In a big way.
Yes. I mean,
4 games, 4 home runs.
It's not like we needed his bat, but it's nice that he stepped right in and continued to do what he does. It just shows, having a veteran like him in the lineup is going to make all the difference.
And they always said about Nelly Cruz, if he hits the ball the opposite way, he's really feeling it.
dialed
has
in.
He not had what three out of the four home runs, but in opposite field.
Yep.
And they're like, and there he's just. He's so effortless. That swing is so effortless. He just leaves the ballpark in no time.
Yeah, it doesn't even look like he's trying.
Yeah, and did you see that one home run he hit? Was it two home runs ago? The ball was like the highest. It was the highest hit home run this season so far. The ball like was in the air forever, and it finally landed like right in the first row of left field.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see that one? And it was in the air forever, and the guy was just like, what's going on?
Yeah.
But it was in the air forever.
Having a snack. Right. In the outfield.
Yeah. So,
good thing we're not at the dome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just shows his strength, though. Like, that, even like a bad pitch will get it out of the stadium. So.
But yeah, batting 333 since he came back. 7 for 21, 4 home runs, 6 RBIs. I joked around on Twitter. I was like, all these home over the last weekend, all these home runs are great, but they're all solo shots.
Yeah,
it was like most of them were solo shots. I mean, it sounds dumb to be complaining,
right?
But it's like, come on, can we just get a guy, at least one guy on? It doesn't have to be a grand slam or even a three. Just get one guy on, and then
I get so frustrated too on some of those where you get Buxton on base, right, and he steals second, ends up tagging up and getting over to third on a fly ball, and then the next person comes up and hits a home run, and it's like, well, yeah. Glad we were able to manufacture him over to third to clear the bases anyways.
Jeremy's mad about us scoring runs.
Yeah.
Sorry, man. Sorry we got to score runs, man.
Yeah.
My bad. Oh, jeez.
But yeah, speaking of Buxton.
He should be hitting first. Am I wrong? Okay, I know this is an argument. Everyone's like,
yes.
I know you guys might be against me on this, but everyone's like, well, when he hits first, he just goes back into the cellar and isn't playing great. It's like, well, try it. I mean, Kepler hasn't been a great leadoff hitter.
And I went back and forth.
I feel like 15 home runs says otherwise. Kepler's been killing.
But he doesn't like make the plays on the base paths. Like,
yeah, he's not your prototypical. But other than the first inning, he's got Buxton coming up in front of him. So
right. And that's what I was saying. I was going back and forth on Twitter with a couple of guys about that, and it's if we needed him to bat first, then that's fine. But I don't feel like we need him to bat first.
No.
And I feel him coming up in the ninth spot, like you said, he after the first inning, he sets the table then for the rest of the game,
mm-hmm.
for the next 3 to 4 at bats for the top of the lineup, he's going to be up there for him. So
right.
I get your point. Yes, his type of player, speedy, and hitting decent for average. Yeah, you want him at the number one spot to get on there at the beginning of the game. And I'd say if we had like three of the less players that are in our lineup, then yeah, that would make sense. But I'm fine with him now. But I bet you within the next 2 years, if not next year, he'll eventually be a number one guy. I just think we don't need him to be right now.
Exactly. And I feel like if he's comfortable in that 9 spot and he's doing well as he is, I mean, he's up to 270.
Yeah, that's a good point.
If he's comfortable, let's let him keep doing his thing. He's playing great defense. He's swinging the bat well. Let's just keep it rolling.
Yeah. Once again, the problems of having a deep lineup,
right,
but it's interesting to watch Rocco change the batting order almost on a daily.
It's every day, yeah. It's crazy.
I saw Polanco let off Sunday, and maybe Saturday, but now I saw the lineup for tonight. Kepler's leading off again, and Polanco's back in the 2 spot. So I mean, and where Kepler was like in the 6 or 7 spot.
I did not see that actually. I was out of town, but yeah.
Yeah. So they just constantly be switching up. I think Crone even batted third or something.
Okay.
Or fourth over the last like 4 games or something. So I do like how he's constantly switching it up. And like I said, we'll see. Buxton will eventually be the leadoff hitter. Might not be this year. Might not even be next year. But he will eventually be in that spot.
Yep.
I feel.
Yep.
He'll eventually be one of the best leadoff hitters in the game.
Yes.
I mean, he's got the speed. Once he gets the bat consistent up at the top there, I mean, he's hitting doubles like crazy. Like, he's going to be great.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we got Polanco.
Consistent.
Exactly. That's all I was saying all weekend on Twitter is consistency. And that's what makes him – that's why, for me, he is the team MVP.
Without a doubt. And people will argue it, too. Like, we actually had this chat. I think some of us friends here had a chat on the group there. I'm thinking, you're Bo was 100% right. Like, Rosario went through, they say, three 0-for-13 slumps this year and like a couple 0-for-20, or is it 0-for-20 slumps a couple times? And it's so. And then Kepler's gone through his own recent 0-for-some slump. And I think Polanco's longest is like 0-for-9 or something crazy like that. Like, are you kidding me? So he's been crazy. I mean, he's been great.
What's kind of funny about that, though, is the difference between Polanco and Rosario. They both have exactly 246 at-bats this year. Polanco's hitting .333, Rosario .272. It's a difference of 15 hits.
Mm. Wow.
It's actually a lot closer than you would think. Mm. I was looking at totals earlier, and I was just like, oh my goodness, like they're really close.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Math.
And I would say, you know, Rosario is right behind him because of his power and just everything else. But I feel Polanco is the one that really gets the team moving.
Mm-hmm.
And just like I said, it's about consistency.
Yeah. And, you know, with Rosario's power, this is another stat I thought was interesting. You know, in the same number of at-bats, they have a total difference of 6 total bases. Rosario has 134 total bases. Polanco has 140.
Mm. Wow.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's very interesting how close they are. Like, I mean, if you look at on paper, yeah, 100 or, you know, hitting .333, you're thinking, okay, well, Polanco's definitely the guy. But Rosario, you know, with those power numbers.
Yeah, so and, that helps him, though.
You know, numbers. But he's also hitting for average. Like, he's actually got a lot of hits. So I think it's a little bit closer than we really give Rosario credit for.
Yeah, no, it's no, trust me. I have no complaints about Rosario. it's you know, if you put a gun to my head, I'd be like, Polanco. But Rosario is like, they're like 1A and 1B.
Is that what you tell a shooter?
Yeah.
1A, 1B. I swear. Okay.
1A, 1B.
Okay, fine.
But, yeah, so, like I said, you know, Krohn also been very solid again, batting .300.
He's been good. I like him a lot.
I am pleasantly surprised because I didn't know what to expect with him coming in either. But I have, you know, we've talked about this, Jeremy, when you're on the first time that both of us ended up picking him as our newcomer MVP.
Mm-hmm.
He definitely surprised me and also kind of consistent. He hasn't really, I mean, I think he started the year a little slow, but you know, he's been very solid.
And his defense
for a while now.
Right. And his defense has been good, but he's had a couple of like super boneheaded plays. Like, have you noticed that? Like he'll have like a great scoop. And then the next time he'll like miss a flip to first base. You're like, what? But he's one of the top, I think he's like number 6 in first baseman fielding percentage in the league right now, and he's playing pretty, and he's getting the all-star votes too.
I was gonna say,
oh my goodness,
yeah, he's what, second place in first baseman.
I can't believe that.
Like the Twins are actually getting recognition this year in the all-star voting. Yeah, it's multiple crazy. Starters,
right? So if you're listening to this, all you gotta do is Google the name of the player, and all you gotta do is just, you'll see a thing that says vote for this player. So vote for your Twins. I mean. They're all, a bunch of guys are up for, and Polanco's up there, and Rosario's up there. Buxton is not getting enough credit, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree.
And Krohn. So just go out and vote for your Twins.
Yes.
Because I think out of the top all-star outfielders, I think I saw both Rosario and Kepler on the list, and I did not see Buxton.
Mm. Oh, I don't know. I didn't see the Kepler, but
I just saw the ones that were up there because the Twins posted it on Twitter, mm-hmm. kind of showing where everybody was. But they said, yeah, give the outfield some love. They said, let's get them into the top 9. So we have none of the 3 outfielders are in the top 9 mm-hmm. of votes mm-hmm. right now. But yeah, it's like I said, just consistency all the way across. But well, I think that's plenty of Twins talk, and of course. For people who listen to the show, they know I am, even though I love the Twins, I'm a diehard Viking fan.
You're a Vikings fan? No way.
And
weird.
You know, weird, right? And so obviously we got to talk about Rudolph here quick before we get into the Stinger Spotlight. We talked a little bit prior to it, but overall, Kyle Rudolph, I'm surprised it ended up happening. All I can say is in Rob Brzezinski we trust. I mean, the guy is a master. I can see, pay him whatever he wants. I'd never want him to leave this team until he retires.
Right.
He is a master of the cap. You know, overall, you know, we talked just before we went on air here, and we talked about how a lot of all the guaranteed money is kind of up front. It's very front loaded, and I think they did that on purpose so they can. You know, I would have guessed he was going to be gone after this year anyways, but now I think he'll be here for 2 years.
Well, that's a safe assumption, yes. I mean, and like we were talking about before the show, I think we all like Irv Smith. Obviously,
the potential is
right. Mm-hmm. We just haven't obviously haven't seen anything yet. If he flops, Rudolph might be around a little longer. But who of the four tight ends? Do we keep all four of them now? That's what I keep thinking of too. Like, because we're not going to let go of Morgan.
Yeah, because he's a good blocker.
So Conklin might be the odd man out, which is kind of weird because he played decent into your last year. But anyway, back to Rudolph, though. I like the signing. I mean, if for chemistry and just
taking Irv underneath his wing type of thing. I mean, that they've been both of them been talking about that since day one, how he's going to help Irv out, and Irv's super happy that he's helping him out. And
he's a great, and Rudolph's a great teammate.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
And he's a great community guy, too. I think, you know, when you look at all the stuff that he does with, like, the children's hospitals and everything, like, he's just a good guy to have in the community, and he actually wants to be in Minnesota. Like, that's something that I think that you kind of underrate, you know, sometimes. He's doing great work in the community, and if he wants to be here, you know, like, I'm okay with giving him a little bit more money than you might typically do, but you know, let's keep that guy here, and ultimately, like you said, Bo, he's probably going to be here 2 years. You know, it's kind of a backloaded with the money, you know, front loaded with the guaranteed money, to give the Vikings a little bit more flexibility down the road.
Exactly. And that's and people who have listened know that I'm not I like Rudolph, but I would have been fine if he would have walked away, if we would have got rid of him, just because I feel like he never reached the full potential that now I think Irv Smith could do with his athleticism. But I'll gladly take him for another year or two, have him help out Irv Smith if that's the difference, but making Irv take that step up into elite type tight ends, getting up there with the Ertz and the
Kelce.
And the Kelces and the Kittle out of nowhere, you know,
which is weird.
But you know, that's where I want, you know, I always felt like Rudolph was another tier down from those guys, but I want that elite type tight end. And I think Irv Smith has that. And thank you, Rudolph, for doing that, because he ended up saving us $4 million on this year's cap. So now we have a little bit of movement for possibilities if anything happens.
Right.
But so I think we all agree overall, good plan. Probably gone in 2 years. Trade him to New England.
Yeah, right.
I'm sure they'll still take him.
Yep. Jeez.
But you know, I think we'll kind of wrap it up right there, guys. Thank you both for coming in and talking.
Thanks a lot for having me.
Appreciate it.
Absolutely. I'm happy to be back.
Yes. And we'll go ahead and go into the Stinger Spotlight here. Please. I apologize for some of the interference in the Stinger Spotlight. We were moving a bunch of things around here in this office and a lot of background noise. So I apologize for that during the Stinger interview, but we got to figure it out. So go ahead and take a listen.
It's time for the Stinger Spotlight, brought to you by Anytime Fitness in Wilmer, Litchfield, and Marshall.
All right, and now it's time for the Stinger Spotlight. I got Cal Elvers in here. Thank you for joining me, Cal.
Thanks for having me.
You went to Sacred Heart Griffin High School in Springfield, Illinois. What's the baseball culture like around there?
You know, it has a pretty good baseball culture. A couple guys before me, a couple classes before me, really made Sacred Heart Griffin a good baseball school. By the time I was a senior there, it was kind of my job just to keep it that way. So, you know, it was really good going to school there.
Awesome. And after high school, you committed to Miami of Ohio. Not the fun Miami, but Miami, Ohio. No, just kidding. I'm sure all that's great. Were there any other schools that went after you at all?
Yeah, you know, I talked to some other schools in the Midwest, like Illinois, Xavier, some schools in the area. But, you know, Miami's coaching staff, the campus, guys on campus really just seemed to do it for me. And, you know, the last 3 years is something I would never change. So it's been really enjoyable, and I can't wait to go back for this next year.
Awesome. Well, you already answered my next question, which was, why did you choose Miami, Ohio? So I thank you for that. But let's go into your college stats a little bit. You had a good freshman year. You batted around 279. Mm-hmm. You followed up that with your sophomore year, kind of down a little bit, a 191, a little bit of a struggle. But then you came to the Stingers.
Yeah,
as because you are a returning player this year, and you batted 271, which is a solid season.
Yep.
Then went back to your junior year, 306.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, do you feel playing the summer with the Stingers helped prepare you for your junior year, or helped make you get you to take that step?
Yeah, no doubt. You know, like you said, after my sophomore year, it was kind of a rough patch, and I got into Wilmer, and I started working with Al Leyva, our hitting coach, and, you know, Bo also worked with me, and they just did a great job of, you know, making me look a little more details into the game, and taking that back to school, it really helped me out, you know, as you were saying, and I felt like going into the school year, I was much more prepared, and I think, you know, the Stingers did a great job of helping me. Just in the Northwoods League, there's good pitching everywhere, there's good talent on every team, so it's a great experience coming here every summer.
Yeah. Well, awesome. Obviously, they liked you being here because they brought you back. You're only one of a handful. So, so on to the Stingers. You know, you obviously, like I said, obviously they liked you. You liked coming up here. You know, what did you enjoy the most about playing up here last summer?
I just think the atmosphere is awesome. You know, we played a lot of different ballparks, and Wilmer seems to always be my favorite. You know, even though it's my home field, there's something about playing in Wilmer, and I enjoy the people, I enjoy the town, you know, my host family lives in Spicer, and I really enjoy Spicer, and coming back this summer was a no-brainer when I got asked, so I'm happy to be back.
Awesome, yeah, no, it's, when the Stingers came here, obviously this is their 10th year, when they came here, I knew it would work well,
because
I knew the culture of the town, and they did, you know, Mark and Ryan do such a great job, and I believe, even though we're like the smallest, or maybe the second smallest market, mm-hmm. we're not in the amount of fans that show up. We're more in the middle of the pack, which, like you said, it just goes to show what the area and how they back the Stingers.
Exactly.
You mentioned it a little bit, but tell me a little bit more about how the Stingers coaching staff has helped you over the last year with your game.
Yeah. So when I got in last summer, you know, the first thing Al worked with me on was just getting my timing down. I think. You know, come from the school year, a lot of my foundation broke down on my swing from just not being on time consistently. Mm-hmm. So when I got here, it was kind of what we worked on for quite a while. And coming back this summer, even now, it's kind of something, you know, I'm working on now. It's a tough thing to really develop into every swing, but a lot of elite hitters do it. So, you know, if you want to be good, you got to, you know, practice things that aren't easy, and that's kind of what I'm still working on.
Yeah, I can imagine it can be a little difficult because you're talking about fractions of a second.
Exactly.
That you got to be quicker, and how can you, you know, it's like, well, you got to be 2 to 3 seconds. Well, that's easy to be 2 to 3 seconds faster.
Yeah.
But just that fraction of a second to get the bat around.
Yeah.
With your hips and everything else, I can imagine that being difficult to really nail down, especially consistently.
Right.
At bat after a bat. So and I know I asked you before we recorded, but go ahead and who's your host family this year?
Stacy and Judy. I'm gonna mess up this last name, but I think it's Flabio.
I'm sure you're not the first person to not get there.
I'm still working on it.
Yeah. No, it's good. And you said they're up in Spicer?
Yeah, they live in Spicer. You know, they live on a lake. It's a beautiful house.
Nice.
And, you know, it's super nice that they opened up their house for me for the summer. And, you know, I thank them a ton.
Yeah. It's nice to get you on a lake up here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, that was kind of the beginning of the conversation here. Let's go on to the kind of our quote-unquote rapid question segment.
So,
I'll just do quick questions as quick as we can.
Okay.
Come up with an answer as fast as you can.
Okay.
Depending on your answer, we might go on a little side tangent if something interesting happens. So we'll start off here with favorite color.
Blue.
Favorite MLB club.
Cubs.
One thing you can't live without.
Ooh. My dog, Wrigley.
Ah, nice. Favorite thing to do in your downtime?
Hang with my friends.
Favorite all-time baseball player?
That's a good question. I'm going to say Cal Ripken Jr. just because I was named after him.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I was named after Cal. All my brothers were named after baseball players, actually.
Oh, say all of them were named after Cal?
older brothers named after Ryan Sandberg.
Okay.
Younger brothers named after Will Clark, so I got Cal Ripken Jr. So
your family likes baseball, you're saying?
Actually, my dad's a football coach, so I don't know how that one got worked out. My dad's a football coach, and we're all baseball players. So.
That's funny. I loved Ryan Sandberg since you're a Cubs fan.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I'm 39, so I grew up with Ryan Sandberg, and I played second base back when I played baseball. So.
Yeah, that's a good one to look at.
Yeah, exactly. So the one food you can never get sick of?
Crab Rangoon.
Oh, I'll say it first. Crab Rangoon, okay. Favorite TV show of all time?
Entourage.
Favorite movie of all time?
Good Will Hunting.
If the baseball thing does not happen to work out for you long term, what would you like to be doing?
My goal would be to work in a front office of a major league organization.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just go in the background.
Yeah, I like baseball, and you know, I have a getting a finance degree, so that's kind of the goal, and I don't really want to leave baseball, but I don't mind the business side, so it kind of seems like a good fit.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. Ford or Chevy?
Ford.
PlayStation or Xbox?
PlayStation.
Burger King or McDonald's?
McDonald's.
Smell you hate the most?
Smell I hate the most? I'm just going to say trash in general, like old trash when you're taking it out. You know, I lived in a college house, and, you know, there's trash seems to linger, so when I could get that out, it was just more enjoyable.
Yeah, I hear you. Smell you love the most?
Fresh cut grass.
Mm. God, who was that? I think that was Mark's answer when I had them on.
Yeah.
Superhero power you would want?
Fly,
nice. Favorite musical group or artist or each?
Probably Eric Church.
Eric Church?
Yeah.
Awesome. And of course, you can listen to Eric Church on K95.3.
Yeah, absolutely.
Favorite holiday?
Christmas.
Yeah. Nice. Well, that is the end of the rapid question segment there. Cal, thank you for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Wish you luck the rest of your season with the Stingers. Wish you luck in your senior year in college and just overall with baseball and your profession as you move forward.
Thank you very much.
Hey, thanks for coming
in. Appreciate it.
All right, everyone. That wraps up the show for the week. Once again, thank you to both Tim and Jeremy for joining me. And thank you for Cal for coming in and doing the Stinger Spotlight this week. Thank you all for listening, and we'll see you next week.